The Yuan, or Mongol dynasty, lasted less than 100 years. Basically, Kublai Khan's successors were not as able as he was. The term Golden Age probably gets thrown around a little too freely in discussions of Chinese history. But the successor Ming dynasty, together with the much earlier Han dynasty, really does seem to earn this label. And just to round out our dynasties, I should note that a final dynasty and another non-Han Chinese dynasty, Manchus, took power in 1644 and ruled until the fall of the empire in the early 20th century. Beijing's Forbidden City remained the center of imperial power throughout this dynasty, but most of the essential structure was established during the Ming dynasty, so that's where we'll begin. The Ming dynasty initially established its capital in southern China, in Nanjing, but the third Ming emperor moved the capital back to Beijing. You need a break from the disembodied voice, right? So let's watch a short clip from a good National Geographic video about the Forbidden City. This wasn't entirely clear in the video, so here's a map of the old city of Beijing. Note that there are three walls. There's a wall around the outer city, there is a wall around the imperial city, and there's a wall around the sacred heart of the city, the so-called Forbidden City, which is our required work. You'll see more of the video in a minute, but I want to make some points about the sacred and political geometry of the Forbidden City. This plan is one of the five required images of the Forbidden City. And here's a labeled version of the plan and the three specific buildings on the required list with their placement. The final image is an aerial view. I'll put that up in a minute. This is not a required image, but it shows you the layout of the Forbidden City, and it shows that it was prescribed by a complex Chinese cosmology. It's laid out on an axial plan. Remember that the square or rectangular shapes represented the earth, and the emperor ruled over the kingdoms of the earth. Like the pharaoh, he mediated between his people and the heavens. It was the emperor's sacred duty to maintain cosmic order from his throne, central to the Hall of Supreme Harmony, whose placement was at the center of the Forbidden City. So this symbolized the emperor's placement at the center of the world. Note that the most important buildings lie along the central north-south axis. It's all very rectilinear, but you might keep in mind that circles are the shape of heavens, and we see circular altars. The Forbidden City is also laid out in threes, which is a sacred number in China. In Chinese culture, three represents yin, yang, and their unity, so three elements. The private residences are in groups of six, three times two. The roofs have three tiers. There are three central ceremonial buildings beyond the meridian or front gate. So here's the last image, which is an aerial view. So let's return to the video. Think about and take notes about how the organization and decoration of the space reinforces the emperor's dual religious and political roles. We'll head back to the video in a moment, but first let me make a couple more points about the way the Forbidden City was structured and constructed. This is a plan for a traditional multi-generational family compound in Beijing. Note that it too is organized on a north-south axis. The head of the family lives in the principal house on the north, and the other families are assigned houses strictly according to rank. So Confucian hierarchy also determines the layout of Chinese domestic and imperial spaces. Note that while the Forbidden City buildings are huge, the vast scale is a big part of the message of power and authority. They are built of wood according to the same construction plan we just saw used for the smaller buildings. Traditional Chinese construction is post and beam, or post and lintel, like Greek temples. And like Romanesque cathedrals, Chinese post and beam buildings can be expanded by adding new bays formed by beams and purlins. The limitation is that the bay can be no longer than the trunk of an available tree. What makes this distinctively Chinese is the curved eaves. Let's return to the video one last time and learn about the private living quarters of the emperor. And you won't forget about dragon symbolism or lucky colors, right? The required image on the upper left doesn't show up in the video or the Khan Academy essay, so let me just say a few words about it. This palace was built by an emperor as his retirement home, but he died before he could retire to it, and he decreed that no one else should ever live there. He began to build in 1772, which makes this a Qing, not a Ming work. I'm guessing the College Board included the interior shot because it's considered one of the most beautiful classical Chinese interiors to have been preserved. The emperors lived well. Okay, I'm really running out of time, and the homework readings on this work were excellent, including the original artist's analysis of his own objectives and techniques. So let me just warn that this work shows up in a number of test questions. If you skip this homework, reconsider that decision. So instead of retelling the narrative, which is not entirely accurate anyway, I hope you picked that up, I want to pose some closing questions. How does this work fit into the traditions of Chinese art that we've examined? Well, look at the landscape in the background, the towering mountains, the clouds, the mist, the highly decorated foreground. I'm betting this painter knew his Fan Quan. And what about iconography? Okay, we have an umbrella instead of a dragon, but it's still symbolizing leadership and with the additional message of hard work and willingness to brave the elements. There's also a lot of red, green, and yellow, or at least gold. In fact, I'd argue that this painting is in many ways all about the mandate of heaven, bestowed upon a new emperor. As it happens, this was an emperor in some trouble. Mao's reforms had unleashed famine and a popular backlash, and the Cultural Revolution he instituted to restore ideological purity was tearing the country apart, and in fact, it was repudiated by Mao's successors. If you would like to learn more about Chairman Mao, I've put a great video up on Moodle entitled Great Leap Forward, alas, and I've indicated the best parts of it to look at it. We don't have time for it now. So how does this represent a departure from Chinese tradition? Well, the original was painted in oil, not ink. Oil paint is very much a European material. The figure in the landscape, far from receding into significance, dominates the page. Fan Quan would be shocked. And finally, the painting and the subsequent poster, the most reproduced poster in world history, are examples of a very European art form, socialist realism. There's one last work that will appear on the test. It's another global contemporary work, and I'm going to talk about it in my test review podcast. We'll return to this work in the spring, of course, but it relates closely to the poster of Chairman Mao, so I wanted to introduce it in this unit. For now, if there's any time left, let's close with a clip about socialist realism and the propaganda art that the artists of the work on the right would rebel against.